This event is organized as part of PublicTexts at IIHS. PublicTexts is a series of conversations with authors about their work. It is hosted by the Word Lab and the IIHS Library. Flyers are available at the registration desk for the library. We're open from Monday to Saturday from 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. Today we have Nandita Jayaraj and Roopa Pai to talk about writing about science for children based on their books, 31 Fantastic Adventures in Science and From Leeches to Slug Glue. Fantastic Adventures is by Nandita and From Leeches to Slug Glue by Roopa. They will be in conversation with Aparna Kapur. The books are available at the Lightroom bookstore in the gallery. Nandita Jayaraj is a science journalist and co-founder of the feminist science media platform, thelifeofscience.com. Previously, she worked with The Hindu and Brainwave Science magazine. Since 2016, she's been traveling the country in search of the hidden contributions of women in science. Nandita also writes and edits children's books. Her latest being 31 Fantastic Adventures in Science, which she co-authored with Ashima Fredog. Roopa Pai is one of India's best-known authors for children. This computer engineer has written over 25 books, ranging from picture books to chapter books, fiction to non-fiction, on themes as diverse as fantasy, popular science, maths, history, economics, life skills, philosophy, medicine. Many of these, including the award-winning The Gita for Children, are bestsellers and are enjoyed as much by adults as children. Her latest book, From Leeches to Slug Glue, 25 Explosive Ideas That Made and Are Making Modern Medicine, was published in September this year. When she's not writing, Roopa has found leading children and young people on history walks around her beloved Karnataka in her capacity as director of the heritage tour company Bangalore Walks. Aparna Kapur, our moderator today, most of Aparna's friends are imaginary and she's happiest when she's creating worlds and stories. She's worked as the assistant editor for the children's science magazine Brainwave and has written several comic books for Amar Chitra Katha. She's also written a picture book, Ghum Ghum Gharial's Glorious Adventure, and co-authored a middle grade novel, Ruckus on the Road, for Puffin. When she isn't writing, she can be found poring over a book or pouring herself a large cup of coffee. Over to this cheerful bunch.
Can you hear me? Hello everyone. We're here to talk about Nandita and Roopa's new books and about writing science for children. And we're also going to talk about just writing for children in general and what draws them to science and why children should read science books. So I'm going to start off asking you, what got you interested in science when you were kids? What is the one book or person that made you fall in love with the subject?
Hello, yeah. So when I was very young, my uncle who lived in the US, he sent me a subscription to National Geographic Kids. And it was such a fabulous magazine. We used to really wait to receive it. It was full of all color pictures and everything. And it talked about very, actually, complex science, but in such a simple way. Of course, a lot of it was natural history, so more animals and birds and insects than other things. But other stuff was also there, so that was fascinating. And a little later in life, it was this magazine Target, which was a cult, iconic Indian children's magazine. They had a monthly column on computers, which were very new at that time to us in India. And there was a person there called Sugato Mitra, who then became head of NIIT or something. I mean, he was seriously into computer science, a really big scientist. But he used to author this children's column, and Ajit Nainan used to illustrate about the innards of a computer and how exactly a computer worked. And I think that was the moment when the flip happened, that I never had realized that science could be written in such an engaging and fascinating manner. And I completely understood how it worked. So I think that was my starting point.
I always try really hard to answer this question, to think back to this, one inspiring moment. But it wasn't there for me. It was really an accident. I think I started studying science mostly because I was good at it in school, so it was the default thing to do at the time. And I was and I enjoyed it, but I really did not start loving it till I left science. So I mean, while I was studying science, it seemed like something very very abstract, something I couldn't really relate to, but I was able to grasp and understand and score marks in. But the moment I left science and I started looking at science from the outside, I realized, you know, how wondrous it is and how amazing these little things that are happening inside us and in the world, and you zoom out and in the universe, and it really bothered me how none of that came through to me while I was studying. And I was very affected by how many more generations are probably going by without experiencing the real joy and wonder of science. And I thought I was doing something very revolutionary by doing science journalism, which wasn't very big then. But the more I started doing it, I got introduced to people who have been writing about science for decades before and have been doing it so beautifully. And I'm glad that at least in the past 10 years, it's become more of a talking topic. So yeah, that's how I fell in love with science.
Even I always say that I love science despite my teachers, because the way people teach science in school isn't really the ideal way to get kids interested in it. So if there was one thing you could change about the way science is taught in school, what would you change? Nandita, we can talk with you.
It's hard to answer this because I've also been engaging with a lot of educators, and I really understand the kind of challenges that they go through. So I would love to say, let kids go outside and let's have fewer exams and just, you know, play with our hands and go to the... I mean, I recently had the opportunity to be part of a paddy harvesting tradition, and I saw how much of physics there was in the winnowing practice and all of these things, you know. So and if, you know, that is the way I feel that kids should learn science. But that said, it's easier said than done, and there are
a few. What are some of the challenges that educators
just
face?
Because of the system, the education system today, and the kind of things that schools are tied to, if kids want to get into an IIT and or the engineering colleges, which are still the aspirational thing to do, and still education is something that most of our children today are doing for the sake of jobs. And if you want to get into an IIT or NIT or one of the top so-called top universities, it's still necessary to go through this kind of very unimaginative school system. Because I don't know if there's been any studies on this, but I do see that kids, when they are exposed to some of the few more liberal school systems where they're allowed to, like CFL, I listened to a talk by Kamala Mukunda recently over here, and I also saw that a lot of those kids go on to do things.
But sometimes I feel all that's missing is an inspired teacher, actually, because, and science is hard. A lot of it is very abstract, you know, especially as you go to the higher classes. Children are born with curiosity, it's true, and biology and tactile things that you can see and observe, that love for those things is easy to cultivate. With, again, persist with faith, you know, trust in the process. At some point when you're older, everything will fall in place and you'll get it. But yeah, the challenge is in helping them stick to it, and I don't know how to do it. It's just you have to reveal the wonder of it. A teacher who's excited by the subject very easily passes it on to the children, infects the children. So maybe we should be investing more in training the trainer, because when they have reached a stage when they are ready to teach and they're adults and they have studied science, then if you bring to them, this is how what you know is actually... Yes, like I said, I understood very little science when I was growing up. So now when I understand it, I have my aha moments. And before they go away, I write it down so that same aha is conveyed to children. And I don't hesitate to introduce sort of complex concepts to them. So because I feel that even if they don't get all of it at that point, they will eventually, at least the spark has been ignited and they can look for other sources to explain the same thing, but at least there's a curiosity. So I come from that, and vocabulary wise, I don't know, I've never held back on using the words I want to use because I think children won't understand them, because I was a reading child myself and I never understood half the words, but contextually you understand and eventually you get it. You know, as long as you keep the tone conversational and engaging and you have like the storytelling kind of approach, like, and I keep saying, did you know, and wow, and how exciting, like, so whatever is happening to me, I put it down and it seems to work. I don't know. Yeah.
Yeah, I think even when I write for a general audience, something, especially when it's science-related topics, one thing I always try to write in a way that a high school student can understand. And we tend to look at that as, you know, write so simply that even a high school student can understand. But in reality, I feel our high school students probably will understand more of this than an adult who sometimes think that, okay, this is not my topic, and you know, and just gloss over it. So when I write for adults, I always try to make sure that at least a 13 plus year old kid may understand it. And similarly, even this book, even though we call it 10 plus or 12 plus book, that it's still, I feel that something that is the level that is required even for an adult who has been out of touch with science for many decades to write. But that said, it's a totally different experience for me writing for really young kids, which I've felt, well, I've written for Pratham, when I always start off trying to write a level one book. And it always ends up as a level three. So I have really realized how hard it is to write for younger audiences. How complicated it is to stay simple. And for me, it's a challenge being a science journalist and, you know, I spent years trying to squeeze in as much information as I could into a 300-word article. And now I have to write this maybe 200-word storybook. And my instinct is to just cram it with information, you know, if it's about color, like write everything about color and waves. But then I really learned that is not the top priority at this stage. This is not a textbook and you want a kid to pick up the book and not, you know, not be prescribed the book. So I agree a lot with what Roopa was saying. Introduce them to, you know, concepts and let them take that thing that they don't understand and imagine and fill up the blanks, and maybe in the coming years start connecting the dots. And another thing that we discussed a lot while writing this book, which is actually a profile of 31 women scientists, but it's as much about the science that they do as it is about the scientists themselves. So while communicating the science in these books, Ashima, the co-author, and I, there were a lot of to and fro's where we were deciding how much, what is jargon and how much we should stay away from it. And we finally realized that let's not eliminate jargon. We don't want to dumb down these concepts because these are also some very modern, very very contemporary scientific topics, very interdisciplinary. And so we didn't want to dumb it down so much. So don't be afraid. I mean, I agree there's a lot of jargon we can avoid, but don't be afraid of bamboozling them, because I think kids like to be bamboozled now and then. And so there are a few words which they might be like, what was that? But sometimes they sound fun, so we kept it. And we also kept a glossary in the end if they want to look back at it. So I think the key is to not patronize kids so much. Talk to them like they are your equal, especially with science, because I think as Roopa's, I read the last page of her book, and it said that science is as much about realizing that we don't know so much. Yeah. So really there's no need to talk down to kids.
Yeah, and to add to that, I agree. I mean, kids love jargon. They love using it to show off. Even if they don't understand it completely, they love throwing it at their adults. And, you know, using jargon, the advantage of it is that it takes away, it stops being intimidating the next time they encounter it. It's a familiar word. Otherwise, when they're growing, you know, this, my daughter, when she was in kindergarten, their teachers used to say, where do you come from? I came from my mother's uterus, because this, otherwise we used to say stomach, and all, and you know, they told us, but kids are going to be really puzzled. They'll say, did you eat me first? You know, how did I come from your stomach otherwise? So, but we said, uterus, I mean, do you want to introduce those words? And they're like, yes, because when they, that's the right word for it. And if they're open to understanding stomach, they're just as open to understanding uterus. Every word is new to them at this stage. So, just because it's unfamiliar and scary to you, don't project that to your children. So, I think, yeah, jargon for the win, I think. Use jargon.
So I want to talk more specifically about your books. Firstly, I'm a sucker for listicles. So I'm very happy that these have been condensed to 25 ideas and 31 people. But how, Roopa, did you condense the entire history of medicine into 25 ideas?
It was hard. It was hard to choose the 25 because, you know, the way I picked this topic was, you know, after I wrote the Gita for children, which I had not read the Bhagavad Gita in my life until I started researching for it. But having done that, it gave me the courage to pick up any topic that I'm curious about but know nothing about and say, I'll do a book on it. Because to do a children's book on it is the best way to understand a subject. Like you were saying, that you must know the subject very well to be able to simplify it. If you don't know it well enough, it becomes like patronizing, superficial. You know, if you know it well enough, then you can figure out a way. So I did some book on economics, which I had no idea what it was about. So I said, okay, let's try that. And then just randomly, I picked medicine because my family is full of doctors. So, you know, that's one way to prove to them that I know more about them than they do. More about medicine than they do. So, but when I started, it was like with absolutely new eyes. Because what I figured out recently at the launch of my book at St. John's was that medical students don't study the history of medicine as a subject. So even to them, this is a new topic. So the first pass, I asked doctor friends of mine, which are the main ideas in the history of medicine that I should include in this book? And they sent me a few, but they weren't very enlightening. I mean, stuff like regular stuff, antibiotics, vaccination, you know that stuff, right? That was the first thing that had come to a layperson's mind also. Then I began to research, and then I found there was so much stuff and so many names, and it was all so fascinating that, yeah, I had to keep making lists. First from 50 to, and then I did a lot of cheating by crunching 2-3 ideas into one so that I didn't want to leave anything out. Yeah, again, randomly I said 25, thinking, okay, 25 ideas. So I'll do like 2,000 words on each 50K word book. That seems, because I always have to break it down. That's my mind works like that. I break it down, then I can do chapter by chapter. It's easier rather than saying, I'm going to write a 50K word and don't know where to start and where to end. But eventually it ended up becoming some 75K word book, and it just kept growing. It was super fun, super enlightening, and a wonderful experience.
And Nandita, how did you pick your list, your final list of 31? And I want to ask you about the decision to include women who are working today in science. Why did you make that decision?
Because invariably, answering your second question first, if you ask anybody about name five Indian scientists, it's very likely to be C.V. Raman and Ramanujan, Subramanian, you know, nobody who works today. So, because I think this could also be, both of us are journalists, so we know a lot about the here and the now. And so it was important to us, to talk about contemporary scientists and to not just talk about the heroes of the past, but maybe introduce some people who could be the heroes of the future. So that was the reason that we, and of course, already our scientists from history have been written about to a decent extent before. So this was something new. That this is also something that we've been doing. We've both of us run a project which has been documenting the work of active Indian scientists. So it's a spin-off from that. So that was one of the elements we were sure that all these people should be contemporary. And about the 31, it was, again, we had to start off deciding a number because the publishers are willing to print a set number of pages, or we could have written 150, I'm sure. But so we actually settled on 30. And we were deciding this based, the number one criteria was make it 30 as different fields of science as possible, so that we could talk about as different type of research and what kind of work goes into these research. So readers can actually get a sense of what is it like to be a paleontologist, or what is it like to be an astronomer. So we didn't want same kind of storylines repeating as far as possible. So the first criteria was that. And the second one was diversity of stories of where the scientists came from, what kind of backgrounds they had, and what kind of trajectories they've had. So we wanted a diversity of stories there, so hoping that there could be something in it for everybody who's reading. And also, if hopefully the book is translated to different languages, then, you know, somebody from maybe Karnataka can read about a scientist from Karnataka and relate a little extra to the kind of childhood she had, or the kind of challenges she might have faced, and feel that, you know, you're not alone. So so we were looking at 30, and it was kind of hard because we were looking at north, south, east, west, central, northeast, and we wanted everybody. And we found 30, we were able to shortlist, and we reached 31, and we couldn't go anymore. And we also, and then we also talked about, okay, maybe we have to remove this person, maybe we have to remove, but it just didn't feel right. And then we decided, we managed to convince our publishers about 31, because we felt that this sort of odd number conveyed the sense of, this is not a complete list. There are many more. This is not about 31 ranked scientists, the 30 ranked scientists in India or something, but it's just 31 of the many, many, many amazing people here. So that's, yeah. Someone said that you can read one a day in a month. So it's many rationalizations.
Was there anyone who was on your long list that you were very, very disappointed didn't make the...
Not really. I mean, I think after we shortlisted and we had this 31, we were really happy with this 31, which is why we didn't want to reduce it. So there wasn't anyone in particular. I feel like everyone we've interviewed about 150 to 200 scientists so far, and all the sort of patterns of stories and the elements of stories are there in these as well. So I mean, I was not very heartbroken to leave anyone behind. I don't see this as, you know, something that everyone has to be on.
Roopa, your book and your writing in general, it's like just a friend telling you a story. It never feels tedious in any way, no matter how intense the subject is. How important is that tone, or how important is humor in while you're writing for children, especially in non-fiction?
I'm actually just being me. So I don't put any thought in it as to what style I adopt. I have, whether I write for children or adults, it's the same tone, or whether I'm talking to somebody, it's the same tone. It just happens to work well for children. So that's good. I mean, it happens to work well for adults as well, you know. So, but I would say now, if I, in hindsight and analyzing my own writing, yes, definitely humor is a very important component of writing for children. And storytelling. I think everything is a story, really. You know, you can, even if you take the people out of it, and I'm just telling the story of the evolution of a particular idea, it's still a story. And if you can bring that storytelling aspect to it, you have them. I mean, that's how I would react myself as a reader to anybody telling a good story. And that's why, you know, I mean, going off topic a little, I feel that any which way in which children choose to consume stories, it's fine. They don't all have to be readers. I mean, that's a strange thing for a writer to say. But I really feel that there has become, like, you know, there's too much emphasis on reading as a way to consume stories. And while it's good for someone who's naturally inclined towards reading, I think life lessons and stories can be consumed in a variety of different ways, and all those ways are valid. So as long as you can tell a story through a movie or a sport or you know, a piece of music or dance, all valid forms of, yeah.
I think this would be a good time for you to read a little bit from the book.
Okay, so very difficult once again to pick one idea to read from. So I picked a short chapter because, just tell me when I'm running out of time. It's not very long. So this is about how anesthesia came into practice. So it's crazy to think that until, what, let's see, how many years ago was it? 160, 180 years ago, all surgery used to be done without anesthesia. I mean, that's so crazy. That's the, you know, this is why I wrote this book, actually, to impress upon you, because, you know, I said we have a lot of doctors in my family, and my sister is a doctor herself, so very close, I have had a very close association with a doctor. My older sister, so, you know, she used to come home from medical college in her first year talking about corpses at the dinner table with great excitement, and what she found on dissection and how smelly it was. But the way she talked about it with so much excitement, it conveyed itself to me. And then she became a gynecologist, and I could see that she was held in such high esteem. She was treated like a goddess by people who had their babies or their delivered by her, and she would get so many gifts and, you know, homemade biryani and sweets and saris, and all of that used to come home. And 25 years later, 28 years later, she's working just as hard, sacrificing her social life and everything else. And now doctors have taken on the sheen of some kind of crooks, extortionists, who are only there to send you to labs for unnecessary tests. You know, that's such doctor hate. You know, and I felt like, you know, we are dissing, and also this whole dissing of modern medicine, the anti-vaxxers in the US, and like, every, you know, antibiotics are poison. And as I said to myself, you know, if you lived 180 years ago, you'd be singing a very different tune. I mean, this would seem like utopia, unbelievable fantasy, the kind of, we're living longer lives, we're living more disease-free lives, we're living pain-free lives. You know, so part of my thing was to remind children, because children have no agency in this. They only hear what their adults say, and they also assume that doctors and medicine is like some terrible thing. So it was to impress upon them that it's all very recent, and you please be grateful, like, learn to count your blessings. I mean, to bring the wonder of the journey of how modern medicine came to be. So, mention the word surgery and most people will run for cover. Now, mention, if you dare, surgery without anesthesia and you're likely to start a proper riot. But that fate worse than death was an actual reality for the world until a few good men, Humphrey Davy, Hanaoka Seishu, Horace Wells, William Morton, James Simpson, came along and delivered us from that particular evil. Why did it take until the 19th century for a proper, read, effective, safe, and proven anesthetic to be employed during surgery? Simply because surgery was not a common procedure at all. Very often, understandably, patients chose certain death from an illness over a surgical procedure that was horrendously painful and not entirely foolproof. If it hadn't been for an unrelated parallel development, the sudden interest in the scientific community in different kinds of air, anesthetics, and therefore surgery may have remained on the margins of medical science for much longer. So have also in this book, there are a lot of these unexpected parallel fields, like everybody who came upon these, you know, discoveries in medicine were not necessarily doctors at all, or, you know, they were established some. So that brings out that whole multidisciplinary nature of all science and all humanities, which thankfully is coming back into focus in our education systems, that science and humanities are related. And they were not even called scientists, they were called natural philosophers. They were just interested in nature. And anyway, different kinds of air, yes, and it was Robert Boyle's experiments which caused him to suspect that one kind of air was responsible both for sustaining life and helping things burn better, which helped kickstart the general interest in the components of common air, the air around us. It was called common air. In 1754, British chemist Joseph Black isolated carbon dioxide, which he called fixed air. In 1766, his fellow countryman Henry Cavendish discovered hydrogen, or flammable air. In 1772, Black student Daniel Rutherford removed oxygen and carbon dioxide from common air and discovered that the remaining air neither supported life, because a mouse exposed to it died, nor did it support combustion, that is, a candle could not burn in that air. He called this remaining air, which we now know as nitrogen, noxious air, okay, and so on. And then in 1773, a Swedish chemist called Scheele discovered oxygen, which he called fire air, because it supported combustion, but he did not immediately publish his findings, allowing Joseph Priestley and Anton Lavoisier to claim the credits for that discovery. Okay. But it was Priestley's book, Experiments and Observations on Different Kinds of Air, published in 1775, that really got everyone going. One of the people fascinated by the airs, particularly in terms of their possible applications in medicine, for instance, could inhaling a particular air cure asthma? What about tuberculosis? Was English physician Thomas Beddoes. In 1798, he established the Pneumatic Institution for Relieving Diseases by Medical Airs. These people were really into long names, for instance, in Bristol, to investigate the effects of inhaling different airs. The first superintendent of that institute was a 20-year-old called Humphrey Davy. One of Davy's jobs as superintendent at the Pneumatic Institution was to inhale different airs and record their effects on himself. When he inhaled nitrous oxide, and this is the wonder of a scientist, you know, just that extreme curiosity which will allow you to go headlong and barefaced into anything, you know. So when he inhaled nitrous oxide, he was astonished to find that he made him laugh uncontrollably and nicknamed it laughing gas. And, you know, before that he had inhaled things like nitric oxide, which combined with the saliva in his mouth to become nitric acid and burnt his mucosa. And another time he inhaled carbon monoxide and of course nearly died. And when he was being carried out into the fresh air, he still, this inveterate scientist, still took his pulse and recorded that it was thread-like but not entirely absent, and hastened to assure the people who were carrying him out, I do not think I shall die. Okay, anyway, so So he figured out nitrous oxide, made him laugh uncontrollably. He named it laughing gas. In his book, Researches Chemical and Philosophical, Chiefly Concerning Nitrous Oxide and Its Respiration, published in 1800, he wrote that the gas appeared capable of destroying physical pain and may probably be used with advantage during surgical operations. And here I say, as usual, you know the drill now, because it's happened many times earlier in the book. No one paid the throwaway line any attention. And the first surgical procedure using laughing gas, a dental extraction, wasn't performed until 44 years later. Meanwhile, Davy made a habit of having his friends over at the institute for some laughing gas tomfoolery before he could quit his post in 1801 and so on. With news of the jolly times to be had with laughing gas spreading across the world, another similar gas, diethyl ether, whose pain-numbing effects had first been discovered in the diethyl ether made a comeback, especially across the Atlantic. In the 1830s, get this, ether frolics became a popular entertainment across America, with volunteers inhaling the gas and then staggering around the stage in a very cheerful mood indeed, much to the amusement of the audience. One of the people who had participated enthusiastically in ether frolics, both as a volunteer and as an observer, was the physician Crawford Long. He noticed that when people were staggering around under the influence, many of them bumped into things or fell and hurt themselves, but never seemed to notice the pain. That got Long thinking, and he decided to try an experiment. Okay, and various. He tried, one of his friends, James Venable, had been told to get a couple of tumors removed from his neck, but had been consistently putting it off because he was terrified of the pain. Long suggested he get it done after inhaling ether, promising him that he wouldn't feel a thing. Venable agreed, and Long performed the surgery painlessly and successfully. This was the first time anyone had used ether as a general anesthetic, but Long did not publicize. This is another problem. They didn't publicize immediately, so they don't get the credit, you know. Now, in 1844, a dentist called Horace Wells was at a nitrous oxide, not an ether demonstration, but a nitrous oxide demonstration conducted by American showman Gardner Quincy Colton when he noticed that nitrous oxide seems to make people oblivious to pain. He insisted that Colton administered laughing gas to him the very next day and got a tooth extracted painlessly. He then himself proceeded to conduct several painless tooth extractions on his patients over the next few weeks. Excited with the success Wells was having with using nitrous oxide as an anesthetic, his business partner William Morton arranged for Wells to demonstrate the technique at the famous Massachusetts General Hospital in 1845. Equally excited, Wells obliged, but the demo was a failure. The patient cried out in pain in the middle of the extraction, and the watching audience rose in disdain, yelling, "Humbug." Okay, and this is the thing. The surgeon used to perform. He was a performer. They had no anesthetist, no nurse, nothing. He was a solo rock star. He used to perform in the middle, and there would be tiers of seats around where people used to sit and watch him do this. No concern as to the germs they were carrying, because germs were not believed to be the cause of infection or disease at all. And that's why, historically, the theater where operations happen, I mean, the room where operations happen is called, and is still called, an operation theater. Okay, anyway, a year and a half later, in September 1846, now William Morton, the partner who had encouraged this guy to try the extraction, and he had failed, Wells had failed, so Morton himself performed a painless dental extraction in his clinic using ether instead of nitrous oxide. On 16th October 1846, he was back at the MGH, the Massachusetts General Hospital, with his fingers tightly crossed, this time to himself publicly demonstrate the efficacy of ether as a general anesthetic during a proper surgical procedure. After Morton had administered the gas to a patient, part of a tumor was removed from the patient's neck by John Collins Warren, the former dean of Harvard Medical College. The patient stayed unconscious through the entire procedure. When he came to, Warren asked him how he felt. "Feels as if my neck has been scratched, sir," said the patient. Warren turned to the watching crowd. "Gentlemen," he smiled, "this is no humbug." The room erupted in cheers, and a brave new age of surgery was born. The operating room at the MGH was renamed the Ether Dome, and to this day, 16th October is celebrated annually as Ether Day to commemorate the glorious occasion when humankind triumphed over pain.
Thank you. I want you to make an audio book of this, although it'll be exhausting, but yes. Nandita, a lot of your work is focused on women in science specifically. And did you feel a lack of role models growing up? Is that where this stems from?
I think it was less. There was a lack of role models for sure. I mean, for the simple reason that we are not often told about female heroes when we are growing up in school or whatever. But I don't know, maybe, of course, I'm sure that experience did play a role also. But more than that, it was while working at Brainwave, which is a children's science magazine, which Aparna also worked for. So it was there where Ashima and I used to make content and write stories and edit stories and work with artists to make this monthly magazine. And we had a lot of history of science and everything in the magazine. So we noticed that usually when the writer comes in most of our timelines, it was filled with, great men who have done great things, usually white men. And also artists who, actually, we were working with a really amazing set of artists who, you know, very, very imaginative and innovative and very young. But still, sometimes when we had even a fictional story where we talk about a generic scientist, or we'd always get the same kind of visuals of gray-haired, crazy, Einstein-y looking person. So we, you know, I mean, we used to go back at the first draft and tell them, okay, see here, there's no need for, you know, talking about a specific scientist. So why don't we mix it up? Why don't we make them look Indian, sometimes make them a woman? Because after all, it is kids reading this, and our readers were both boys and girls. So it's really unfair if the girls have to grow up seeing only scientists who look a certain way, or even boys. So we started off doing that a lot, but it was a little limited because you couldn't, when we're talking about non-fictional stories and actual history of science, it's not so easy to find out about the non-men who've contributed to science. So I wonder, please, be interested, yeah, to hear.
No, very difficult. Yeah. I had to put Florence Nightingale.
Yeah.
I like that.
but also it's interesting, a lot of, you know, grad students and scholars in the West mostly are now doing this thing where they're going through really old scientific articles and looking at the acknowledgement section, and they find that a lot of times there are really crucial acknowledgement, but for whatever reason they didn't get authorship. So that is these insidious ways where women's contributions are being hidden, and hidden figures. Yes, yes. So yeah, so I think it was all of this that made Ashima and me very oriented towards leading a concerted attempt to look for women's contributions. And as journalists, it's not our job to look for heroes, but just to report realities. So we fully took that liberty and started doing that.
So you're essentially trying to undo all these many, 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 many years of one-sided history that we've all read. Do you ever feel disheartened at the enormity of the task?
No, I mean, I don't look at it so much like that, because actually this is only the starting point. If anything, I think what we're doing is, see, the people who can actually undo this damage is people who are in positions of power, like who are giving grants to scientists, who are deciding who gets the awards, who gets the promotions, you know. So if anything, we just want to broaden this pool and open their eyes to, you know, there are all these people doing these things, so that then they can take these more meaningful steps. Because the way, I mean, there's also a lot of questions people raise, like, why only women scientists? Why have you talked about this woman? There's another person doing this better than her, you know. So it's not so easy that just because we're doing this, people, you know, take it positively, then we would move ahead a lot faster. But yeah, it is, it's disheartening sometimes when people ask, okay, but what about men? You're not being fair by not, you know, acknowledging the contributions of men. To which I say, open your textbooks, open your newspapers. That is what is being done all the time. So, but then, you know, I just take it with a pinch of salt. We're okay with making a few enemies.
I'd like you to read, you have a section of the sociologist who's doing work, studying sort of the history of why women have been left out of science, or trying to understand why there aren't as many women in science. Yeah. So could you read a little bit from that?
Sure. So this is one of the chapters which I think, so one thing is when we talk about, even though we call it adventures in science, we define science in a much more loose and a more wider umbrella, because there are sociologists, there are psychologists, economists that we have profiled in this book. The only thing we look at is whether they're doing research and employing the scientific method to find out something new. So this is one chapter that we had on a sociologist called Namrata Gupta. So Namrata is a sociologist who studies women in science. And she was thoroughly disconcerted when we asked her if we could include her in this book, because she said, what? I mean, I'm not a scientist and I study women in science. How can I, be in this book? But it was important to us to include this because it does sort of give the context to why we need a book about women in science, because kids, again, it's about treating kids like adults, and we don't, if we don't give them the context, kids might grow up thinking, why are there so many books on, for girls' stories and girls. So there is a reason that there are books for girls or featuring women contributors. And that is because historically, women are one of the many marginalized groups. Because of various reasons, they have not been able to rise where they are. And that is the reason we don't see so many women in our textbooks. So there was a lot of talk, and finally Namrata got convinced and she agreed to be in this book. So I'm just going to read an excerpt from her chapter. Bridging the Gender Gap in Science. Namrata found her way into science through history. She loved books on history, especially the histories of strong women. When she was old enough, she wrote her master's thesis on the position of women in society through history. Subjects like the history of society and science might seem like they're worlds apart, but there are many connections between them. Science is in fact a social process because it cannot be done alone. It requires interaction among many people, laboratories and organizations, Namrata says. For her PhD, Namrata combined the sociology of science, the study of lives of the people involved in science, with her interest in the progress of women. A statistic she came across shocked her so much that she quickly framed her research question around this: why are there so few women in science? The statistic she saw in 1999 reported that 36% of women training in science in India were women, yet only 10% of Indian scientists were women. Scientific institutes in the country had almost no women bosses. These statistics remain almost unchanged today, 20 years later. The many years after her PhD, Namrata continues to look for answers behind this gender gap. No matter what you feel like, a boy, a girl, neither, or somewhere in between, it should not dictate what you do in your life. There are a lot more similarities than differences among people of different genders, don't you think? No geneticist, psychologist, or neurologist has ever found that men are better at doing science than women. In fact, all the amazing women scientists through history, although fewer in number than their famous male counterparts, proves that women are really good at science. Then why are the numbers so different? This is the excerpt that I want to read, and then hopefully you will read the rest yourself and find out why. Thank you. There's also one that I thought I would read, which is a little more sciencey. Though I don't want to call one thing sciencey or the other, but a more traditionally sciencey chapter. This is a the story of a neuroscientist called Vidita Vaidya. She works at TIFR in Mumbai. Reading the Brain's Mind. 4-year-old Vidita watched the caterpillar sway in the wind, dangling on the thread that it had woven. The caterpillar would soon wrap the silken threads around its body to build itself a nice, comfortable cocoon. As she gazed at the busy little creature, she wondered, how does the caterpillar know how long the thread has to be to make the perfect home? Over the years, Vidita came to realize that all the decisions that animals make come from their brains. Even the most basic action, such as looking at this book, is controlled by your brain. Your eyes are seeing the colors and words on the page. Light signals from your eyes are converted into electric signals, which travel across nerves to your brain. Your brain then converts the visual information into actual images. So it may look like it is the eyes that see, but it's actually the brain that is doing the seeing. Similarly, it is the brain that smells, hears, speaks, and feels too. When she realized the amazing powers of the brain, Vidita decided that she would spend her life solving its mysteries. Her parents, both doctors, inspired her to follow her dreams. It's not easy to become a brain scientist, but Vidita was ready to work really hard for it, and it paid off. She was able to study at the top universities in North America and Europe to train to become a scientist. Working under international experts in neuroscience, she quickly grasped the tricks of the trade. Years later, at 29 years of age, she returned to her homeland to set up her very own neuroscience laboratory in Mumbai. Her lab is a scenic research institution on the shores of the Arabian Sea. Together with a team of dedicated younger scientists, Vidita is trying to decode the neuroscience of emotions. Our feelings are complicated business, and this is exactly what makes humans special. Behind all of the joy we feel, the tears that fall, and the drama we experience is the brain. The brain is made up of cells called neurons, which are connected to each other so that information can travel from one end to the other. It's like a giant network of circuits. But what is fascinating is that this network is not fixed. Every day, there are minor tweaks being made. New contacts between neurons are created, and previously linked neurons that are not in use anymore are disconnected. Vidita calls this quality of the brain plasticity. Just like plastic can be melted and molded into different shapes, the brain's neurons connect and disconnect as we go through life. Yeah.
So one interesting thing I noticed was that you both have spoken about the structure of the gene and Rosalind Franklin's contribution to it, but you mentioned it very briefly in your introduction in your chapter about genetics, and it's it's just a few sentences. But the way the story is framed is slightly different, in that Nandita focuses more on how Rosalind Franklin's contributions were unfairly not recognized, and you've spoken about what her contribution was, but not so much about how unfair it was that it is called the Watson-Crick model. So does the subject that you're talking about frame the way you tell the story? Can you talk a little
bit? Most certainly, I think. Yeah, it was for me also there was a paucity of space that also framed the story, actually. But, you know, I was very disturbed by Rosalind Franklin's omission from the Nobel Prize, so I mentioned that part. But since the rest of it seems so much like a conspiracy theory sometimes, then you don't want children to entirely lose out the wonder of it. So I have put some snide remarks about Watson and Crick, but I didn't focus on how they denied Rosalind Franklin her her due. Yeah, and also in my case, that kind of story had been repeated earlier with male scientists as well. So I didn't see it particularly through a feminist lens. I was looking at it as how random events and all kinds of authority and not so much patriarchy as who is the boss, politics in academia determines who wins and whose name gets into the written in stone and how others get left by the wayside.
I think it's important to figure out a time and place to discuss these things. And obviously, if it was a biology textbook or something, if I was writing text for that, I probably wouldn't have gone so much into the injustice of it. And where I mentioned Rosalind Franklin in the introduction comes in the context of, you know, why we need such a book and how historically women's contributions have been ignored. And I appreciated, what I don't appreciate is when in textbooks people do, often, I don't know if textbooks have changed, but Rosalind Franklin is often not even mentioned. And I feel that considering the limitations Roopa had, I really appreciated her snide remarks. And it makes a huge difference. I would have felt very differently if she hadn't mentioned Rosalind Franklin at all. But I feel that in that paragraph, it did. There was something I feel like a alert kid would be like, what exactly happened here? And maybe they would go and find out what happened. So It does, for sure, the context and the kind of approach changes things.
Roopa, you've addressed it in the book, but there is so much of medical history that we, so many things that only happened because of animal trials, and you've spoken about it, but even when you have, you've left it open-ended. Did you feel the need to take a stand, or was it a deliberate decision for you to remain impartial?
Yeah, deliberately. I always, when I'm writing for children particularly, I'm very, very conscious of putting my opinion as the opinion, or sort of making them think a certain way because I feel it. Because I feel I'm also limited in terms of how I have arrived at my opinion, and I would prefer that children arrive at it by themselves. So I usually, this I'm very, very conscious about, that I present always both sides and then say, leave it to, what do you think? What do you feel? I don't want to put my opinion in. Yeah. So because animal testing is, it's one of those, you know, debate topics for schools that you can debate endlessly about. And some people feel, I mean, how can you experiment on animals and do such awful things to animals to further human knowledge? And others feel, but, you know, what is a human life versus an animal life? You get into such philosophy, and we would not have reached here. Would you have preferred that? So it's best left to individuals. And if you want to sit on the fence about it, that's fine too, until you have better data or until you're sure, you know, best to leave it open to kids, yeah.
I was curious though, but what if you were discussing a topic, you know, which has a really dirty history, where, you know, black people were experimented upon. Do you think there's a line where, you know, somewhere it's important and is
maybe, but even then I would say this is what happened, and I would present it in the most grisly way possible. I wouldn't whitewash it, but I wouldn't say this was wrong. I would say, what do you think, you know? And I always put those little questions here and there, so that
That's what's important, give them the enough information to decide for themselves. But a lot of people don't do that. They only give one side. Either side, it's
not fair. Nandita, would you have done it differently?
No, I think, I mean, I also, because this is a question that we confront, because we call ourselves a feminist platform. It's something that's always on our mind, you know, how do we are political, but how do we do this right? We don't want to tell people what to think, but we do want to tell them what is going on. And often that is not done. Everyone is afraid to talk. Everyone is afraid to talk about unfairness. So I would definitely say, as Roopa did, I would definitely say this was what was done. This was what went behind. I could... A lot of people would omit it and say that we're not lying but I feel that by omitting it, it is lying by omission. Yeah. So it's really, I would be extra conscious about mentioning it. That's
all. Now we'll take some questions from the audience.
Hello. Hi. So this session is being live streamed, so just wait for the mic to come to you. We are now open for questions.
Hi, I'm Ramya. Roopa, I think both of you have been published. I mean, you're published authors. But when you started off, how difficult, or how was the path to find publishers, to convince them about your chosen topic? How did you strike the balance between what you wanted to write about and what the publishers thought would sell? So how was it when you started off?
So I've been writing since I was very young for newspapers and things. I don't know if any of you remember that. Perhaps it still exists in Deccan Herald, the middle. So I used to write for that. And then I started working in Target magazine, which was my absolute dream job. that job, I somehow, I got it. I mean, that was pure destiny. I walked into the office looking for a job when somebody had quit 1 week earlier. And there were always only 3 editorial people, and as long as I was there, nobody ever quit. So it was just like, I don't know how that happened, but it happened. So after that, it's been sort of serendipity, you know. I never thought of writing books for many years. I was just doing journalism. And then only when I came back from the US, then the first person who got in touch with me to write a book was my erstwhile editor from Target. So she already knew my writing skills, and then and I had huge respect for her. She was my mentor and friend and my first editor. So then we discussed something and I started writing, and that series, Taranauts, helped to establish me as a writer, and after that it was easier to. So I actually, luckily and very, very fortunately, I haven't had to ever convince a publisher that I wanted to write about this, or, you know, it's just happened sort of organically for me.
I'm a total beginner. This is my first. I mean, I've written for Pratham before, and I think that because of Story Weaver, it's so much. It's democratized the whole the publishing ecosystem so much, and that it's not that, you know, you need to be. You need to be accomplished, you need to be a known person, you need to be writing about certain topics to write anymore. And so that, and I the few people that I know at Storyweaver, so they're so open to new ideas. So I think that those kind of projects really helped me. I mean, it sort of put, I never really thought about writing books till then because I was a journalist, but that made me think that oh, maybe I can do this. This book sort of fell into our lap because we had been writing these stories on our website, so there wasn't much of a struggle that went behind it. So I have not yet experienced this pressure to write about certain things. I think if I had to, I probably just wouldn't write the book because it's not my primary job. But it would be different if you are a if you are a author by profession, I'm sure there would be challenges.
Thank you.
Hello. So, I mean, talking about teaching or, you know, explaining science to kids, is it necessary for them to have certain prereqs, like pre-required knowledge or understanding of basic concepts for them to understand higher concepts? Like, for example, one of my students asked today, if the earth is spinning, why don't we spin with it? And I instinctively said gravity, but then I realized that kid doesn't know what gravity is. So is it fine for me to explain what gravity is without, you know, in a superficial way? Or would that be problematic in the long term where they mix up concepts?
I mean, to be honest, since you're dealing with kids, but anything I say would be just imagining. But I don't know, from a very inexperienced point of view, I feel that any attempt to engage with a child who's asking a question and being accurate to the best of your knowledge is a good thing. And it could be wrong, they figure it out, but it's always good to have that conversation. I don't think you should ever stop yourself.
Hello. One thing is, first I will congratulate both of you because of all the attempt you have made. But after seeing the title of Science Fun, I am totally confused just for a moment. Because whatever the reading what both you have done, you know, both includes more than fun, more informative measures. You can't expect the kids or children to get attracted to such thing because they are at the tender age of either for the Tom and Jerry, Nick and so and so, or with a little bit higher, they will go for superheroes like Phantom or anything. Then in what way both you are thinking about to attract the children by writing? That I want to get from your side.
You know, I think reading children, see, first of all, when you write a book, it's mostly children who read who will pick it up. And reading children are usually open to reading anything that is presented in a fun conversational way is what I feel. So that is one hope. Then hopefully I'm thinking if it goes into a school library, then the teachers may use it as a supplementary teaching for when they do, maybe if they are studying vaccination, they'll probably say, go and read this chapter in the library. And, you know, apart from what they're studying in the textbook, if they're studying about Edward Jenner, maybe they will say that. And then once they read one chapter and find it engaging, they will hopefully read the other chapters. This is not meant for very young children, my book. So, I mean, by the age of 11, 12, I think they are looking for alternative resources to make their own textbooks and academic subjects more fun or accessible. So I'm hoping this will fill that kind of gap. Unless you're a reading child who will read anything that comes your way. And that used to be me. So I think I'm always writing for me, actually.
I think it's important to think about that and worry about it. But I think it's not, sometimes we feel like kids like superheroes, kids want Chota Bheem, but it has so much to do with what are kids seeing and what is being thrust upon them. Everywhere they look, it's these things. So it's no wonder that they're being drawn to them. So it's, we are in a sense, I don't know if there's any point in competing with Chota Bheem for their attention. But
it's an option. You offer them choices. Yeah. There is a choice.
And with information heavy topics like Roopa's book and to a certain extent my book, I look at it as, I mean, I feel as not an alternative to textbooks, but just a different way of getting this information than textbooks, by through the stories of people, through the stories of history. So, you know, if maybe kids are not aboard with their textbooks, but if they, you know, maybe have this as part of their curriculum, I feel that they'll learn so much more. So it's fun. It can be fun if they read
it. In fact, somebody actually sent me that feedback that her mother-in-law runs a school for tribal and underprivileged children somewhere near Coimbatore. And the teachers have, you know, started using this book to teach the kids. So I'm like, okay. Because they don't have textbooks. I mean, they don't have prescribed textbooks. They're much younger kids, so they're more flexible with using whatever material they have to teach the kids. And they found that this was engaging. So,
So are schools upfront to authors just so that they invite you over and talk to kids and you understand and are up to date with what kids learn or what they're eager to learn? That is one question. And second is, how is technology changing all this for authors? This whole interaction with kids, I believe it's, I mean, you guys know this, will be probably very important to, write from a kid's point of view so that the kid understands. So one question is on schools and how technology is changing that interaction between authors and schools, or if at all it plays the medium.
The first question, once more, repeat.
Is how upfront are schools in inviting authors over to interact with children so that you guys do your job better?
How are you clued into what children are studying these days?
Actually, that's not,
you
that's
can rephrase
not
that.
My
not studying, not what they do for leisure reading.
Yeah. Actually, that's not my concern at all, what they are studying in school.
Yeah, that was not my question as well. It was not with respect to what they are studying.
Why do schools reach out to authors?
Schools reach out to all kinds of authors, not necessarily those who write about curriculum or anything. So they do. It has become quite a lovely thing now. I mean, considering I've been writing for 25 years and how the landscape has changed for children's authors in the last 10 has been astounding. Like when we, 25 years ago, nobody cared if they pat you on the head and say, how sweet, you're a children's writer. You know, but now it's, people are really, really receptive to having authors come and meet children and read. And when you do a sort of curriculum-related book, I don't think there's more interest, but there is an equal amount of interest. So just because you write nonfiction, you're not left out. It's not just authors are not, children's authors are not connected only with fiction anymore. They are seen as bringing all kinds of stories to the school. And what is the second question? Technology. it hasn't helped us very much so far, I feel. At least as far as social media goes, because we are, children's authors are never in touch with our direct audience unless we go to schools. We are only in touch with parents, and parents unfortunately still are the ones who have to take their children to a library or to a bookstore and decide, allow them to spend the money, provide the funds. So that is there, but definitely social media has helped us reach parents, which is huge. We didn't have that earlier, considering that newspapers and magazines even now give very few column inches to cover children's books or what's latest in the market. So social media has become that place. Technology-wise, I suppose we can, I don't know.
I think research for sure is easier.
Research, oh yes. Research is so much easier, my God, yeah.
I can't imagine a time where we would have had to go to a public library. But at the same time, that very thing has been a little crippling for me. Sometimes I just can't write, because I'm just researching and researching, and you know that you just fall into this wormhole. And you're so afraid to make mistakes. At least I am so afraid to make mistakes, because I feel that, you know, anybody can check very easily, and there are so many versions of the same story. Yeah. So it's really a double-sided coin for the in the writing process.
Yeah.
Technology is as much of a boon as a bane.
Yeah.
In after. Distribute.
I think it's equal. I don't know if children are reading. I think reading children still like books. Most adults perhaps like Kindle or something, because you can carry a lot of books on one device. Certain books are meant to be read, and certain, like Stephen Fry, the British author and dramatist, he said, like, you know, it's like e-books and real books are like the elevator and stairs. Both will exist parallelly. You take whatever suits you at that time. So there was a threat. There was a much foreboding that, you know, e-books would destroy the physical book. No signs of that so far. Yeah. So.
Hi. So like you were saying just now, in the research process, you often come across a lot of different versions of the same story. So how do you narrow it down? How do you decide which version to tell?
I look for the most reliable source. There are some sources you can trust and some that you can't. It's still, I feel, the best if you can reach out. It depends on how far in history you're going. So if it's something about happening now, I would try to reach out to the actual person who was there in the scene, or people who know somebody who is part of the publication or whatever, so you can get first-hand account of whatever happened. But if it is something in history, then I would look for where or how reliable the source is. And if there are multiple variations of the story, then I think present as many as you can, or say that, you know, I don't think it's my duty to pick one version that I believe as the truth.
It's quite hard actually to pick to know which is the, and in on the internet the problem is the falsehoods or the wrong versions get replicated so fast that even saying that the one that appears most often is the correct one is not true. In fact, so you try and keep researching until you find something that sounds, in my case, that sounds like encyclopedias and Britannica, for instance, or whatever, you'll at least know that they would have done their research. But then you try and go to follow that, you know, the most beautiful thing about Google is that you can keep going deeper and deeper, and then you'll find some real treasure which you know is authentic, and it tells you details that some superficial researcher could not have known, and then you know that perhaps this is the correct one. So it's a bit of a gamble, but I think calculated guess, you're usually okay.
So I wanted to ask that how do you work on the storytelling aspect, that science is like full of facts, information or timelines, then, and when you're specifically doing it for children or adults in any, for any kind of audience, how do you work on bringing that storytelling aspect to make it coherent to give such huge kind of information or timelines or whatever? How do you work on that?
Because my work has been extensively based on in-depth interviews with people, what I typically do is use a character. So use a scientist as the protagonist in the story and use him or her to tell the story of black holes or the brain or whatever. So there are these, there are different devices that that you can use as especially with science, but there's also a lot of ways you could do it wrong. Like, again, another thing I learned in Brainwave, the science magazine I worked at, was so we had these characters through which we used to make stories and explain maybe like gravity. So there's sometimes writers, even me when I started out, have this tendency to say, and then they asked, how does this happen? And then they replied, this happens when water evaporates. You know, it's like basically a textbook, but you just put he says, she says. So we shouldn't misuse this these devices that we can... The best way for me is to actually read it out aloud. It's only when I read it out aloud to the kids around me that I realize what I think is working and it may not be working. What I think is really funny and bitty falls really flat when I'm reading out to a kid, you know. So I think that helps a lot for me, reading it out loud, if possible, to a child.
I don't know how it happens. I think I just see everything as stories in my head, so it's easier than to put it as a story. I don't know. I don't see science as a series of facts, or history for that matter, as a series of dates. They're really stories, and if you can just get one thread of that story, you can follow it through.
Have a question? Okay. I have one last question and then we can go. What are the things that you like to read?
I'm a really bad journalist because I very rarely read nonfiction. I read a lot of fiction. I spend almost all the books I read are fiction and very, very different from science and but I also see a lot of, you know, the elements of storytelling that I use in fiction, so I don't see it as a complete separate thing, but I read a lot of what am I reading now? I just finished reading the Booker Prize novel Girl, Woman, Other by Bernardine Evaristo. I wish I had some sciencey book answers for you, but Angela Saini is one of the really good non-fiction books that authors that I like.
I used to read a lot of fiction growing up, but I think in the last 10, 12 years, I've moved almost exclusively to non-fiction, so it's really become bad. So now if I really want to go back to fiction, I have to go to crime fiction. That is my go-to. That is a page-turner. I won't stop. I just adore crime fiction, particularly written by female British novelists. So
okay. Thank you, everyone. And a special shout-out to Nandita's co-author, Ashima, and the illustrator, Upasana, and Rupa's illustrator, Mihir. Thank you so much. You can buy the books at the bookstore outside.
Thanks, Aparna.